BC TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carrol. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the New Arts Alive tonight. And with me, I have a guest, and she grew up in Middle Siberia. Boy, was it cold. And now she's in...
Latvia?
Yeah, Latvia. And she's going to school there. That's also part of the area for which Russia and the Baltic area are concerned. But she's visiting for, what, a week? And what I'd like you to do is give them your name, because I would like it the way it should be pronounced and stated.
Okay. My name is Anastasia Mukhina, and
You're a painter.
It's Russian name. In Russia, it's pronounced like Anastasia, but here in USA, everywhere
350,000 ways, huh?
Yes.
No. That's important to have it so that they can hear it. What I would like you to do is sort of give us, very simply, kind of an covering of what it is that you do. Only a couple minutes, no more. And then okay. We go into it, okay?
Okay. Last year I moved from Siberia, from my home city Krasnoyarsk, to Latvia. And nowadays I'm studying in Art Academy in Latvia. And I choose to become professional artist. Before I was doing some kind of commission works and paintings, drawings. But now I'm studying in graphic department and doing paintings for myself and exhibiting and participating in different kind of exhibitions. So this is my journey, which I would like to tell about today. And nowadays it is paintings.
Okay, and we have the first image then that you have.
Yes.
And you can see it's up on the monitor, so okay. You can see it also.
Yes, I started this it was first painting in Latvia when I moved in September 2017. And trees always attract me. And before a few years, I was going to Lutheran church in my city, in Krasnoyarsk. And when, again, I was reading Bible and Psalms, I found the reason why I'm drawing paintings, why I'm painting that. And can I read some?
Yes, go right ahead.
And that is very special words for me, because our priest in Lutheran Church in Krasnoyarsk, Gleb Pivovarov, he gave me this gift with this exactly phrase.
Okay.
And then I realize how powerful it is. So, Psalm first, about blessed man. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruits in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. So I think trees, it's like a symbol of growing, of keeping, bringing something else. And also it is symbol of stable or renovating, and that is necessary for living.
Well, you see it as something that has depth to it, as far as a singular or a surface quality to it, depth.
Yes.
As I mentioned to you at the beginning when I saw that, first I said, it looks like Kandinsky, and Kandinsky was painting these type of paintings in the early part of the 20th century, about 1908, somewhere around in there, trees.
Wow.
A lot of trees.
And I didn't know that, really. But I'm inspired by many painters.
I mean, the way in which he used the color, and he was painting because that's what he wanted to paint. He was not in an environment of artists. He was in an environment of out in the country. And consequently, he was learning.
Yeah.
And learning is a singular thing. It's self-learning. It's raising questions.
And it is endless process. So when I started with this topic, I realized that it is endless, and you can do different manner, different technique. So I was trying to do more and more about trees, different angles also. If you come closer, it will grow like something else. No one can understand what is that. So
what size is this?
This size is about 40 to 60 centimeters.
Centimeters.
I don't know in inches. Well, it is.
So 100 centimeters is about a
yard.
How
big is this?
This is 30 to 30, so that painting is twice.
Twice this size?
Four like this. Yeah.
Twice this size. So this is about what? 12?
Inches. Yes, maybe. Mm-hmm.
12 by 12, would it be 24 by 24?
Yes, a bit more.
Okay. I mean, it's kind of important so that when you look at a TV screen, everything's the same size.
Yes, and it depends on
the paintings are not usually that way.
No.
Well, let's see another one.
Yes. So that was also what I tried to do. It is mixed media, and previous painting was in oil, and this is with pastel and wax.
Okay.
And I was inspired by these lines. So like silhouette and darkness and some lightning. So it was few paintings in that kind of manner, with lines and that movement I was trying to show. And this is smaller paintings. It's about 12 inches. It's not square, but
it's about 12 by 16. It's horizontal, horizontal emphasis.
Yes. And now this painting is in Krasnoyarsk, so I gifted it to my close friends. And this kind of paintings I started to do nowadays. in this year, 2018. And it is more abstract, but I think tree is recognizable still. And I was doing series of these paintings.
Well, it becomes very abstract, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mean, in a way, yet it isn't.
I wanted to add some abstract manner, but I hope that tree is visible here still. It's like spring inspired me, and blue sky. It was all in Latvia, and
but with the possibility of it becoming something abstract, that means that it has more possibilities to it the way one would interpret.
Yeah.
It's like music.
Yes.
If it only has one interpretation, it's kind of shallow.
And, you know, I did some experimental work. After this painting, I was asking different people about interpretation, what they see, how they feel. And they was given so opposite emotions and so different...
response and feeling to it then. Now this is even more abstract.
Yes, and this this is bigger size. So when I was reading about Jackson Pollock, and really I inspired by his manner, how he was doing with very big canvas. This is smaller, of course, but still it is big. And
how did you apply the paint on that one?
I'm doing with some, not only brushes, it is sticks, knives, and I'm doing these lines. First I drop, then I'm doing
the finger?
Lines. No, but it could be, even body.
Have you seen the Pollock film? Of him painting yet, the hands and nimbus. Okay.
Some parts. Yes. So, some prints, some drops, lines. What I'm doing these days, but also, and this painting I was doing specially for participating here, in small.
That's his small work.
This one.
Yeah.
And here is more realistic paintings, which I did 1 year before. And this is a series of paintings with, how you call this tree? This one?
Are they evergreen? Pine trees?
Yes, pine trees. With pine trees, which is mostly in taiga, in our Krasnoyarsk region.
So that's in the Siberian
mountains, the Ural and rocks region. And rivers. And I was inspired about our nature. And these pine trees is reminding me of my country and rivers and rocks. Mm-hmm. So I was doing that.
Did you paint this in Latvia then or in your country?
I was in Russia, in Krasnoyarsk at that time. And sky with trees, that is also another topic which is always inspiring me. And that is also more realistic, but I did it in plein air, so outdoor. And it was -8 degrees when I was painting outdoor in Siberia this year. This January. Yes, it is January.
Yeah. Is that in
so
oil?
Everywhere just snow and everything, so bluish and white.
What's the normal temperature in the winter in Siberia?
In winter, normal it is -20 and below. So.
That's cold.
That's really
did
cold.
Did you play paint with mittens?
I was.
How does the paint react to that? outside.
It's frozen.
It's
of course. Not only me frozen, painting those. That colors, they become more...
gummy.
Yeah, gummy. It is so. And in winter, these pine trees is like sticks.
I did forget to mention that on the other side is Patricia Goodrich. She's an artist. And
I will call this.
We will be talking with her in the second half about the exhibition at the New Arts Program, the Salon exhibition, of which your work is in that.
Yes.
Along with 66 other persons, which we'll be
talking about.
Big show
this year. Yes. Big show.
Okay. Do you have another one?
No, for now it is all.
This is it.
Okay.
The more exploring qualities I like very much. Where you're not trying to match the skill of drawing, but the act of painting. And I always found out that I had to forget what I was told in the academic situation. To make something, I had to do it myself.
Yeah, that's pretty difficult.
No, it isn't. But it's something that you have to work with. Mm-hmm. And it's very important. But the majority of your first ones were really interesting. Because they have multiple meanings to them. This has more of a singular meaning.
Yes, it is more realistic, more, everything visible.
Yeah. The early one she showed us, which were quite recent, had interesting use of the colors too, the red and the green, the blue, the orange, that gave a real dynamic quality to
it. They were rich. They were raw. They were actually raw, but yes. They were rich. But the way you used them was very free and very thoughtful.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know how it is, because I know Anastasia, that, and I pronounced it wrong.
That's okay.
Anastasia. But that you didn't just continue school. You had a gap of about 10 years in which you were teaching and doing other activities, and then decided to pursue your passion of painting. So you're back in a formal academic setting. So I can see...
That's my passion. In the academics.
No, that's why I said it's difficult then to go back in there and they're teaching you yet to leave that part and do the free expression you're trying, you know, that you're seeking. So
what you are,
who you are, yeah. But to get the papers behind you to...
I'm trying to stay frankly with myself and... to do what I like to do, not only for academia, but for me also.
So it isn't like as if you were a teenager and graduating from high school and then going to university and just staying there. You've had that 10 years or so in between of life. And
it is so.
I should say we met in India.
Well, that's how she happened to come.
Yeah. And that's how, yes, we, and she was exhibiting at an international exhibition there, and so was I. And
many other artists.
And many other artists from around the world. It was a dance festival at the erotic temples in a Indian village. And we were both blessed. With seeing a beautiful tiger in the Panah Reserve. We were. It was an experience we shared, and we've just.
Yes, and now
in,
we're.
Where in India was this?
It was middle part, Madhya Pradesh, Carrol. That is a small city, but there is very beautiful temples, and that is UNESCO, yeah?
Yes, and a UNESCO heritage site. And it was, yes, a very small city.
But so crowdly it was in that festival. They're doing every year during last 25 years.
Yeah? Mm-hmm.
And that was great exhibition also.
Yes, and time. International fans of dance as well as the visual arts. So.
Yes. So
I had a granddaughter who, a junior in high school, spent a year in India.
Oh.
And it was marvelous for her.
Yes.
She came back and was like, what am I doing here?
But the colors are there too. And the
everything changing.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it was a very sensual country.
It is. And that experience which we get there, you cannot get anywhere else. I think different people, different mm-hmm. from.
But extraordinary hospitable people.
Yeah.
Extraordinarily intolerant. I don't mean intolerant and tolerant.
It is.
Yes, it's a mix of cultures. I didn't realize how much Islam was there as well, with the Hindu, Buddha, Christian, and one.
I know that India has 28 states, and they all speak different languages. Mm-hmm. So.
And now we're here.
And now
with
we're
the,
here.
But the small work salon, which is a microcosm of that. I think how many countries are in the exhibition this year?
There's 21.
21
countries and 11 states.
Yeah. I mean,
and that's,
it's an amazing show.
167 works by 167 artists. You can only have one work in it.
Yes. And all have to be 200 square inches or less.
Or less.
Yes.
And yet it is a momentous show. It really is monumental.
It's the 29th year that it's been going on since 1990.
You really do something amazing there. And the reputation of it has spread all over, too. So, and
it's
so I'm
fun.
So glad you are here.
And I'm thankful to you and James for participating in this show. Mm-hmm.
Is there anything else that you would like to bring up on your painting, or what are some of your ambitions?
For now, I just I'm in this journey to fix which is my manner, which is my medium, and I want to choose what is more more for me. So,
what do you want to do? Do you want to teach, or what do you want to do?
I want to paint. Maybe to teach too, because I like very much this process also. And when other people feel this inspiration, how they do this inspiration of creativity, it is also inspiring me. And yeah, I like teaching, I like painting. So I want to do it separately or mixed together. We'll see. Yes.
The academic world is incredible dogma. That's all I can say. It's.
But there are different situations and ways you can teach. It's not all the classroom and limited that way. I've met a lot of artists who are working with different groups, everything from refugee camps to people who afterwards who have had traumatic shocks, and I don't think teaching necessarily means the K-12 or college classroom anymore. I think the world is, you can expand on how you, and what audience you have. So.
Yes, for me, teaching is not only formal, but it can be informal with other group of people. So,
not only. And I think that's much more common outside of the United States.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, the whole culture. Europe's has a real culture. America is lacking in a culture.
Or North America, or United States, because I'll be attending a biennial of indigenous artists in Lima, Peru this year, and it varies between Ecuador and Lima, and part of their program is going into the villages with the traditional crafts and sharing the learning. I mean, learning from them as well as offering teaching. And also in Luxor in February, I may be participating in one, and it's a people-to-people kind of art experience. And so I'll be working there, and I'm sure learning, and it will go both ways. I think there are opportunities in all levels, and I hope I'm bringing some of it back here. You know, and we share a lot. I mean, James, you have opened the doors for a lot of artists with this program, because I know many of the artists, it is their, on their resume, you may, you know, share the resume and all that experience, but for exhibitions for them, it means a lot to have the USA Kutztown New Arts Program show on that resume. And it's allowed artists to enter the country later, too. So, thank you.
Okay. What we can do is, can we move the...
Yeah.
Okay, if she can just...
I can.
The computer to...
Because it would be nice to feature some of the artists then... Who have come
here
there.
We are.
Okay, and then it goes on that space bar.
Did you hear that?
Space bar, there. So, I've seen the show. I missed the opening, the first opening I've missed in a long time. But I did see it hung this year, and every year I say, oh, this is the best, this is the best. So I'm saying it again, this is the best, Jane. certainly in the installation. And I know some of the artists who've exhibited, but I think what we want, I asked James if I could just feature some of the different countries. And so people locally, sometimes you don't look at what's in your backyard. And people should be there. Filling the place, and I understand opening night they were. And this piece is from Agota Veresh, and I'm pronouncing all these words really badly, or names. She's living in the Netherlands now, but I believe originally from Ukraine. And we'll just scroll. Through them and. You know who this is,
yeah,
Anastasia.
Don't move.
Anastasia from Russia, current living in Riga, Latvia. And you know the trees are there, but this is much more abstracted.
Yes.
Okay.
Next.
And this is Anca Sas from Romania. She was here last year visiting, and I believe on this program visiting with you, and also showing at the Romanian Cultural Institute in New York at that time. She is a young artist who's building a real exhibition record, and these series of almost self-portraits are. I think indicative of the kind of process that she's going through now, and not bound to color so much,
as just the pure emotion. But I'm not going to, don't let me, yes, go ahead. I don't want to interpret. Aninda Roy is someone we met in India.
Mm.
And I had told him about the program here. And
he's from Kolkata.
Yeah. And I didn't get anything from him in India, but he contacted me when he saw on the New Arts program the program was coming up. And so, he was here. And this is Catherine Dumont-Chrétien from France. She was in India with us.
Yes.
Too. I mean, it gets to be a small world. Yeah. It really does. And I don't know, James, if you find it, when you look at the exhibition, can you name what country it's probably from the art?
Can you guess?
I don't know that I could do it 100, anywhere as close to 100%, but there is some...
You can
pull some things out.
You can pull things out of certain countries.
Maybe European or
okay
or Asia or Asia Minor. I mean, when I grew up, it was called Asia Minor at that mm-hmm. time, which designated it, or the Far East, which
okay,
is China.
Okay, you can see
Japan.
Those influences.
Yeah. But not countries. I mean, I don't think
the political country you don't see. The border, see the area in the region and the influences maybe of geography and climate and those kind of things.
But it's becoming more because of the cell phone, and you have communication the way it is.
No borders.
It's much closer ties mm-hmm. than there are there. You don't have things here. In Reading, that are totally just here in Reading.
And I don't think it's making necessarily a homogeneous art or a flat art, but I think it can be used to really open.
But it makes it so that there is a common denominator that mm-hmm. today is much more than it was 100 years ago.
Yes, and yet I did a project in Lithuania in 2003, and I had recorded artists from different countries. I think it was 44 artists from 20-some countries, just speaking, not in an interview, but just speaking spontaneously about their creative process and their art. And what amazed me was the universal common core that there was across the artists. And mm-hmm. I think that's one of the things that I enjoy about the international art camps or experiences, that there is that connection, creative human connection too. So I'm not sure. But anyway,
okay.
Let us show, because I'd like to. You see the mother and child?
Yeah.
From Egypt. Chadi. Let me get the Chadi Salami, mm-hmm. not salami, but salami, I think. Okay. And then next would be from the Republic of Korea, Clemen Su. And if you look, he does a lot of work on newspapers and frankly, a lot of female figures. Mm-hmm. It's there. And now living in the United States, but originally from Japan, is Densuburo Oku. It's red peppers. And this artist is from Bulgaria, Dimitar Velichikov. And his work is always intriguing. The light line there, but... there's a connective tissue to all of his pieces. And so Dimitar exhibits a lot in Eastern Europe, but around the world too. And this is an artist that came from Romania, actually lives in Romania, Ectarina Polko, I apologize to you, Katerina, I think. And next, in printmaking and calligraph, is Elena Cristea from Romania. And if you have any questions or comments, you go, I just met this woman last year, and I was so excited she wanted to have something in the show with you, because we had talked quite a bit. Her name is Elena Pomar, from Mexico, and does some abstract works there. And I believe she will be in Lima this year, in Peru.
Is that oil or what medium?
That is acrylic. We were working. Okay. She was working in acrylic on canvas, and very light touch there. For it, I thought it would have been oil or even a watercolor, but she did a thin wash of it.
It looks more like watercolor.
Doesn't it? It is. It is just.
It has a watercolor quality.
Doesn't
it?
Yeah, there's some movement. There's flow.
Thanks.
Esther Lang, from Hungary. I believe she is also an art critic, and does a lot of writing and art criticism, and organizes some of the shows, and a real nice process into seeing her work. And
it's,
we have some of the paintings around, so you can.
It's very difficult to see it in the real.
It is in that
with the glass.
With the glass, you just don't have that. I took the photos
really,
before.
It has a lot of exciting things going on. Like,
yes, and
but you're not able to see them.
Not with, yes, and that's a question when you work on paper. Like this was worked on paper, of course. How to best show it always?
You use a heavier paper.
Well, yes, but in the circumstances.
Well, it'll hold its
yes,
own.
Yes, yes. In
where
the circumstances,
you don't use it on
none was available.
And expect it to hold its own.
No, and this is just a lighter weight paper, certainly. That is one of the interesting things about, you know, traveling in different countries and cultures.
Yeah.
The materials one might have to work with. But it's also interesting to see, I think, for me, I don't know about you, how people will make painting on a leaf so beautiful. I mean, in such works of art, or in the villages, just the trim on the houses and.
Yeah, but some of them don't even have paper to.
No, you don't have
so
paper.
They use a leaf. So.
Yes. Well, and one of the prime attractions, I was out visiting my granddaughter in Cody, Wyoming last week, and I come across the video on in Malaysia, they're making, no, Sri Lanka, making paper out of elephant poop. And that, she thought, was the best thing ever. We had to watch that video I don't know how many times. But that's in this small village, what they discovered was, because the elephants were primarily vegetarian, and there was a lot of fiber in the poop, and the village had started making paper. And it's being sold, and doing the notebooks and everything, and they really have turned it into a business, and a profitable business. So making do with what you have.
I wonder what kind, how many variations of.
They actually showed a lot of them.
Not the work on them, but the work of the paper itself.
Oh.
How many variations can you get from it?
Oh,
because you don't
control on one's diet.
What they ate.
Yeah.
I mean, the ingredients.
I know. This is what you expected when you came here for the show. Sorry. But it was my 5-year-old granddaughter, almost 6, was intrigued by it. And I think rightly so. Today we saw some paper making, but okay. Let's see. I think there is another. Oh, okay. And speaking of paper making and printmaking, this is Horvat. And we call her Ginky because it's a long name. And you can go to the New Arts program to see this one on her crow piece is extraordinary. And the, I will say, again, the printing press that it was done on was not of the highest quality. I think it's been going through and going through, but the work produced is, and that says something to the artist in Horvat. And
well, you learn to work with what you have.
Yes, yes, and not to use it as an excuse for the work, you know.
Or not working.
Yeah, or not working, yes. This is Joanna Palzoka from Poland, and I love the humor in the piece, and again, it's printmaking. And then from my relatives, my grandparents' country, mm-hmm. from Yugoslavia, from Slovenia, mm-hmm. is Lojze Kalinšek. And he's widely collected and exhibited, and makes textures. Yeah. Rich work. And you go from that to Lucian Jelski-Rafan from Romania. And I'm sorry the image isn't better. This is called Hall, I believe. And it's this, you can almost go into the darkness. You know something is there that is almost beyond shadow, beyond light. He also had started making, I think earning a living as an artist purely, it can mm-hmm. be difficult for anyone. I want to tell you, Lucian has wild kind of sense of humor and creates some of the most fantastic one-of-a-kind sneakers that, mm. that are with custom designs and painted to mm-hmm. to go along with his more serious art. But this piece there is actually gone. It's sold. And from Haiti, this is a Sans Soleil, that's like a voodoo painter, is Martial Edouard. And you can see the multiple figures in there. The Marsala is usually twins, so I'm not sure what this would be called because there are three.
But with the Hades, I think it's a very natural element that they have within the environment there with this.
Oh, yes. You'll see the birds, you see the trees there. Mm-hmm. And when you were talking trees, I was thinking yes. of some of the leaf and tree images in Haitian culture. I was thinking of in India and in the Middle East, that tree of life mm-hmm. Images. It's all those connections.
Almost all of the artists have some qualities of that you find in that kind of spiritual mm-hmm. In it. And, I mean, I think it's natural not to, I mean, we think of Haiti as voodoo.
Yes.
But
when they say Sans Soleil, it's saint of the sun. It's not the black, dark voodoo. It's of creation and of light. Mm-hmm. So that's almost the opposite of what one thinks of when you think voodoo. You think of black magic or something.
Yes, yes.
But it isn't like that. It isn't. It's about creation and appreciation of light. And,
mm-hmm. and well, they do it because...
You were there.
They have a smile on their face all the time. Mm-hmm. And they work hard.
Yes.
But they seem to enjoy what they're doing.
And
no matter what.
Dignity, a real dignity.
While I was there, I never heard anybody complain.
No. Not through the flooding of streets or the electricity and they were there for each other and families, so. There's we didn't We don't have that many images here of the Haitian art, but there is a good set, a good number in your show. I think we have another one coming up. I don't know if it's right next or not. There, yes, it is. That's Nesli Richard. And there again, you see the leaf, you see the saint of the sun, you see also the bull, the strong,
colors,
yes. Yeah. And his work will be in the Lima Biennale, Biennial for Indigenous Artists, this year.
Okay, next.
This is from Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Tran Quang, but there's a name before Tran of that part of it. Ying Yuan, it's wrong. Tran Quang from Vietnam. And
they have a totem statue quality to them, don't they? The image.
Yes, and I know you do a sketching. You were sketching today a band in the back garage in Kutztown. It was wonderful. All these unexpected great things that happened to us and crossing of paths. But this was done as part of his sketchbook. He kept one too, but they're... I think a sketchbook of his mind might be closer rather than of images that he is seeing. It's somehow he is present there too, and then whatever else is up there. That's my impression. I may be completely wrong. You can tell I'm drawn to this piece. Not to it. Oh. That is one of mine. That was just a quick study. You'll see there's a blue stork in it. I've been able to go to Romania for several years in a row, and right at the edge of the city that I visit, Aiud, there is a stork nest. Mm-hmm. And I look up to it when I get there in early August to see if the babies are still there. Usually there's two if they are. And also the storks connect me to Morocco and some of the people I've worked there. So I didn't know when I begin, I just start with color and a piece of paper and try to cut off my brain. So that's my blue stork. And this one is sideways. So turn your head a little because I'm not sure about rotating it. And it's another Haitian painting a painting by Haitian artist Patrick Covan, who is the director of the ProMart, founder of the ProMart Haiti program, and he's currently vice consul
France, isn't it?
In Paris for Haiti, and has promoted and helped establish a program for the Haitian art and artists to exhibit outside of the country, and. To make a living, because I think the one thing we found in Haiti was that how much music and art and that those creative things are embedded in their lives and a real natural resource for them. That's Patrick Lovan's work. This is another Haitian artist. His name is Pius. He goes by Pius Pierre Sylvain Augustine. And he, I believe, has like four or five other sons who are painters, but he is the master. He is Sans Soleil also. But the Sans Soleil style, I mean, it leaves a lot of room in it. It isn't one, but you can see the creator's son there also. And no more Haiti here. This is Rich Devlethson from Denmark. And this is a smaller landscape. The other work he had sent for the show is outside the 200 square inch limit, and I so couldn't meet the criteria. So that. And this is a miniature size painting
It's only about 5 by 5 inches.
Yeah. By Stefan Balog, who is the president and founder of InterArt Foundation. And he was in India also. Yes. It's funny how our paths keep crossing and how people network together. He also, in the area, is at the Snow Goose Gallery exhibiting in miniatures. And I think there's just one there that hasn't sold, but this is one of his works. So
together.
Stefan Balog. And that might be, that isn't the end. How did I miss all of these? Okay. This one is Suzy Veroff from Canada now and previously from the United States. But she has lived and worked in Canada for a number of years and is known for printmaking. And this is Stefan Balog's brother, Zoltan Balog, who's a photographer, but he's been doing some experimental finishing with it and adjusting. This is small. And this is small.
It's probably 2 by 3 inches.
Is that? Okay. But like it doesn't feel small, even looking at it.
No, but it is physically.
Yes. Yeah, we didn't have, I thought when we were bringing the 5 by 5 one, because we brought that here, that was small, but Zoltan Balog. And then this is by a Turkish woman, Zumrat Osman. And for a while she was doing a lot of neon work that glowed in the dark and experimental things.
Yeah,
and this is a whole different process she is using. And She was in India. Yes.
Well.
Okay.
Yeah. I remember.
It was quite a group that I was. Yeah.
Yes.
And this is her work, and she's also affiliated with the Biennale. She's on the committee for the Biennale in Izmir coming up this next year.
Okay.
So, and we haven't even gone into the people from the 11 states at all. We were just featuring the international ones here. But when you walk into the gallery there, you have Keith Haring's drawing on the floor, and then all of these multitude of pieces. And it doesn't, you don't see it all in one setting, or I can't. I'll walk one way and then I'll walk the other, and then I'll come back. When I come back to early to pick up the works or anything, then there are pieces I swear I never saw before.
And it doesn't matter which size it is. I see that it is small pieces, but the idea must be bigger than you notice and go deep inside.
Yeah. James, I've never seen you put a piece of yours in the show.
This is the first time that I've never had one in, I think.
Really?
I think so. If not, it's
yours
only
was
the
it?
Second time.
Okay.
No, I haven't been doing anything this small. I do a lot of things on 9 by 12, but...
Well, you do a lot of things a lot bigger, too, because I'm seeing some of the work. We walked in there, and in the back room, we're seeing the new James Carrolls. And so people can do that, too. They can go in the back room. I like that.
It is loud.
It is a treat. It is a treat.
Yes, there's the Salon exhibition is in its 29th year. And I've always felt that every year I get better in installing it. But this year, I felt that I've hit a...
You just hit it out of the...
To me, the process of dealing with 167 works and trying to give each one space to live in and still not be dominant over any of the others.
Yeah.
They have equal... And I'm surprised, but this looks like it happened. But maybe next year I'll have to. I'm a slow learner.
No, I don't think so.
I thought it was, from that standpoint, it was good. And
there's no was. It still is. What, to July 15th you're open?
It's to the 14th.
14th. Okay.
I think. I could be wrong. It's a Sunday. It's mm-hmm. over on a Sunday. And we will have a closing on that Sunday because there is also another show, and that is the Project Wall, which has been up for, by then, about 15 weeks, mm-hmm. 12 to 15 weeks. And the Project Wall is a little different. There's no, you're not seeing an end product. You're seeing a process. Now, I do a booklet on every show that I've done for years because those are end products that are brought in. Mm-hmm. Whereas the Project Wall, I don't make a booklet until the end. And we have examples of different steps of changes or alterations or whatever it is that goes on. So 1 to 3 on the last day, a Sunday in July, you can come to the reception, closing of both shows.
Yeah, and this was the guide that yes. you absolutely need to see the...
Yeah, this is the guide.
The show, the small work show. Now, what are the... You have Thursday or Friday, Saturday? What are your hours?
Well, I have Thursday, Friday, and... Friday, Saturday, and Sunday from 11 to 3. The door is always open. But it's open 7 days a week. If you knock on the door, I'll turn the lights on and you can come in. But we have to go now. The time is depleted. So I would thank you for tuning in. I would like to thank our guests for being here with us.
Thank you.
Sharing.
Our pleasure.
Yeah.
Good night, and I'm James Carrol. Thanks. You...
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.